Hi everyone, welcome to the presentation of Revisiting Homomorphic Encryption Schemes for Finite Fields. I am Vincent Zucca, and this is a joint work with Andrei Kim from Samsung Technology and Yuri Polyakov from Duality Technology. Before getting into the details, let me explain to those who are not familiar with the subject what is homomorphic encryption. Homomorphic encryption is a relatively recent technology allowing users to perform computation directly over encrypted data. And by directly, I mean that the person performing the computation does not need to know the decryption key. It has many potential applications for user privacy, ranging from private search queries to delegation of computation over sensitive data to a remote server. Now, to build an homomorphic encryption scheme in practice, we rely on the ring learning with error problem. So consider the ring RQ, whose element can be seen as polynomial of degree n minus 1, with n a power of 2, and whose coefficients are taken modulo an integer q. Informally, the ring LWE problem states that if you sample a uniformly random element A over RQ, and two secret elements S and E according to some particular distribution over RQ, then the noisy product AS plus E will look as a uniform element in RQ even if you know A. This means that even by knowing A, it is computationally hard to distinguish AS plus E from a uniform element in RQ. This is interesting since now we can use this ring LWE sample AS plus E A to mask messages in RQ by just adding the message M to the first component. Since AS plus E looks uniform in RQ, so does M plus AS plus E. Therefore, a ciphertext will be a couple of elements of RQ, and probably the most convenient way to think of these ciphertexts is to see them as polynomials of degree 1 with coefficients in RQ. Keeping this in mind, we can notice that by evaluating a ciphertext on the secret key S, one can recover a noisy version of the message M. Now, to fully recover the message M, one needs to get rid of this noise term E. The most common way of doing it is to choose a message of Punnett size by taking its coefficients modulo an integer T small in comparison of Q, and then to encode the message either in the least significant bit or the most significant bits of the ciphertext. The first case corresponds to the BGV encryption scheme. In this scheme, the message is encoded into the least significant bits of the ciphertext, whereas the noise is scaled up by T in order to lie into the most significant bits. The second alternative corresponds to the BFV encryption scheme, and this time it is the opposite. The message is scaled up by a factor of roughly Q over T to be encoded into the log T most significant bit of the ciphertext, whereas the noise will remain into the least significant bits of the ciphertext. Notice that in order to be able to decrypt correctly, the noise and the message should not overlap each other. Since the message has a bounded size, it means that the noise E must remain smaller than a certain bound, which roughly corresponds to Q over 2T. Schemes based on the ring LWE are naturally homomorphic for additions and multiplication, which is why ring LWE is very interesting for homomorphic encryption. For instance, if you consider the BGV encryption scheme and add two ciphertexts as if they were polynomial, then you will obtain a new ciphertext which will correspond to an encryption of the sum of the two messages and whose noise will be the sum of the noise of the two messages plus the carry resulting from the additions of the two messages. Similarly, for the multiplication, you'll notice that by writing down the equation, if you multiply the two ciphertexts as if they were polynomial, you will obtain this time a polynomial of degree 2 instead of 1, but this polynomial will also be an encryption of the product of the two messages. Now, by looking at these equations, we can notice that the noise grows with homomorphic operation, and also that multiplications introduce much more noise than additions. And since the noise must remain smaller than a certain bound to decrypt correctly, it means that we must choose the parameter of our schemes according to the number of operations we want to perform.
The direct consequence of this noise growth is that the parameter Q can become very large in practice, several hundreds or even thousands of bits. This is why, for efficiency reason, implementations of homomorphic encryption usually choose to set Q as a product of small distinct prime moduli, where each moduli is small enough to fit on a machine world. Then, the Chinese reminder theorem states that instead of performing the computation modulo the big integer Q, we can perform the computation modulo the small integer Qi, and that this computation can even be done in parallel. This saves us from using multi-precision arithmetic and to handle the carry propagation. The set of moduli Q1 to Qk is usually called the RNS basis of Q. Although BGV and BFV are theoretically equivalent, we can even convert from one scheme to the other when T and Q are coprime, significant differences remain in practice. For instance, BGV has a much more efficient homomorphic multiplication procedure, which makes it faster than BFV. However, using BGV efficiently requires to handle the noise growth dynamically, which makes it harder to use and to implement than BFV. It was also noticed by Kostash, Lane and Player that BGV has a better noise growth than BFV with large plaintext modules. This work aims at reducing the gap between the two schemes in practice. Our first contribution is to modify the BFV encoding in order to obtain a scheme with a noise growth somewhat similar to BGV. We also reduce the algorithmic complexity of BFV homomorphic multiplication. And our last contribution is to develop a more usable variant of BGV where the user do not have to handle the noise growth dynamically. Finally, we also introduced several optimizations for BFV, which will not be presented in this video, but I invite you to read the paper if you're interested. In particular, we propose to separate the tensoring and the scaling in the homomorphic multiplication procedure, similarly to what could be done with relinearization. And we also propose an improvement of the RNS decryption procedure of Halevy, Polyakov, and Shouf. So let's start with the modification of the encoding. For BGV, we've already seen that ciphertext could be decrypted by evaluating them on the secret key and then taking the result modulo T. And as long as the noise V will be small enough so that M plus TV does not overwrap modulo Q, the decryption will be correct. For BFV, it's slightly more complicated since we will need to remove this factor Q over T in front of M too. So after evaluating the ciphertext on the secret key, we will scale the result by T over Q and round the coefficient of the result to the nearest integers. This is equivalent to recovering the message M plus the rounded coefficient of this fraction, which, if V is small enough, will be rounded to zero. Now notice the difference between the two bounds with this RTQ term, which is the remainder of Q modulo T. This term comes from the difference between T over Q and the flooring of Q over T. In particular, when you multiply T over Q with this factor, you obtain not 1, but 1 minus RTQ over Q. Now, if we take a look at the size of the noise after an homomorphic multiplication in BFV, we will see that this RTQ term also appears due to the scaling of T over Q, which is also required in this procedure. And now the question is, what is the dominant term between V input, which is the size of the noise of the ciphertext, and RTQ over 2? So, a fresh ciphertext has its noise bounded by at most 2 to the 15 in size. This means that if RTQ over 2 is larger than 2 to the 15, it will be responsible for the largest part of the noise growth during the first multiplication. For instance, if T is equal to 2 to the 32, and RTQ over 2 is roughly equal to 2 to the 31, this might lead to a difference of 16 bits as compared with BGV on the first multiplication. However, after the first multiplication, V input will be larger and so will become dominant in the equation. So there will be no further growth of the noise due to this RTQ term. So this phenomenon matches what has been described in the experiments of Kostash, Lane and Player. So overall, this RTQ term impacts both the decryption and the homomorphic multiplication. One way to reduce its impact on the noise growth would be to choose the moduli such that RTQ gets small, but it would be more like a patch than a real solution in our mind, and it would also restrict further the choice of the moduli QI. What we propose instead is just to simply change the way the message is encoded into BFV. Instead of scaling the message by the furrowing of Q over T, we just round the message after the multiplication by Q over T. In this way, after scaling down by T over Q, we'll get the message plus T over Q times the rounding error. This means that the decoding error is reduced from RTQ T over 2Q to T over 2Q. And this results in the same decryption and noise growth bound as for BGV. Note that when T and Q are coprime, this encoding can be simply computed in RNS as minus QM modulo T divided by T. Now let me explain how we manage to reduce BFV homomorphic multiplication complexity. So unlike for BGV, in BFV, the product of the two ciphertexts must be done without performing any reduction modulo Q. Why that? It's simply because since the message is encoded into the most significant bit of the ciphertext by scaling it up by Q over T, after the product of the two ciphertexts, the product of the two messages will be scaled up by Q square over T square, and performing a reduction modulo Q would make us lose the message. So in practice, to perform this product without performing any reduction modulo Q, we extend the RNS basis Q with a second RNS basis P, large enough so that the product does not wrap around modulo PQ. After having performed this product, we need to scale the product of the two ciphertexts down by T over Q in order to get back the product of the two messages scaled up only by Q over T as for the original ciphertext. The dominant term after having performed this scaling down by T over Q is the term in K tensor highlighted in yellow here, which is TQ times K times K prime modulo P. And so we need to make sure that P is large enough so that this term does not wrap around modulo P. And in practice, we can choose P with K plus 1 moduli, which is 1 more moduli than for Q. Since the size of P is directly related to this term, our idea to reduce the size of P would be simply to transform this term, which is a multiple of Q, into a multiple of P so that it will vanish modulo P. To do this, we will begin the homomorphic multiplication procedure by switching the modulus of one of the two ciphertexts from Q to P so that the message of one of the two ciphertexts will be scaled up not by Q over T, but by P over T. Then we just perform the product of the two ciphertexts as usual modulo PQ, so that the product of the two messages will be scaled up not by Q square over T square, but by PQ over T square. And similarly, the term K tensor will be scaled up not by Q square over T, but by QP over T. And because of this, the term K times K prime will be a multiple of QP instead of Q, of just Q, and this means that it will vanish modulo PQ and the dominant term will be gone. And we finish the homomorphic multiplication procedure by scaling the product of the two ciphertexts by T over P instead of T over Q originally. And this has another advantage since this scaling can be done directly in base Q, which also saves some computation. Unfortunately, the rounding error epsilon due to the modulus switching of one of the two ciphertexts from Q to P at the beginning of the procedure will be multiplied by the other ciphertext during the tensoring phase and so will be added to the noise. However, since the product of the two ciphertexts will be scaled down by T over P, it means that we can control the size of this error with the magnitude of P. We've proved in the paper that taking P approximately of the same size than Q makes this noise negligible in comparison of the noise caused by the homomorphic multiplication itself. This means that we can take P as a product of K moduli like Q instead of K plus 1 previously. It is also possible to improve further the performance of the multiplication by considering a leveled approach somewhat similar to BGV.
In this approach, both ciphertexts will be scaled down from Q to some integer Q prime dividing Q, and so the products of the two ciphertexts will be performed internally modulo Q prime P prime, instead of QP. Since Q prime P prime will be smaller and maybe much smaller than QP, we will obtain a significant gain in performance. At the end of the procedure, we will scale the resulting ciphertext back from Q prime to Q to get back a ciphertext encrypted modulo Q as originally. The downside of this approach is that it requires to have a good estimate, or at least a lower bound, on the noise carried by our ciphertexts, in order to scale their noise appropriately during the procedure. Because one could be tempted to take a very small modulus Q prime, so that Q prime P prime will be very small and the multiplication will be very fast. But if we do this, the noise added by the modulus switching from Q to Q prime will dominate the noise of the ciphertext, and so we will lose some computational budget. This is a problematic somewhat similar to what we encounter in BGV, and I will use this opportunity to talk about the BGV implementation we've developed in this work. Unlike for BFV, in BGV, the product of the two ciphertexts can be performed modulo Q, and thus we don't need to scale it down by T over Q. This is why BGV homomorphic multiplication is natively more efficient than BFVs. The counterpart of this efficiency is that the noise is not scaled down automatically by T over Q, and thus will grow quadratically if we don't reduce it manually. To reduce this noise manually, we rely on the modulus switching procedure, which allows us to scale ciphertext and thus their noise down by one integer. The problematic is therefore to have a precise estimate of the noise carried by the ciphertext in order to choose the size of the integer accordingly. To solve this issue, HLib, the reference implementation for BGV, includes a dynamic noise estimation mechanism so that before each multiplication, the noise is scaled down to a minimum level. This requires to have an additional set of small prime integers that can be combined together to scale down the noise by the right amount. In this work, we propose an alternative approach which does not require any dynamic estimation. In our implementation, all the parameters will be fixed at key generation, and so the user only needs to indicate the maximal number of additions or rotations he needs to perform between two multiplications. From these parameters, we will know how large the noise can become in the worst case, and we will set the size of the moduli qi forming q accordingly to this bound. Then, after each multiplication, the ciphertext will be scaled down by one of the moduli forming q, and we won't need any additional set of prime numbers. So overall, our variant of BGV and BFV have the same decryption bound and the same noise bound for addition. The noise after a multiplication in our variant of BFV is equal to roughly to delta square T V input, whereas for BGV it is twice larger. This factor 2 comes from the fact that in BGV, after each multiplication, the noise caused by module switching adds to the scaled down noise. Since the scaled down noise is set to match the module switching noise, we obtain this factor 2. BFV has also another small advantage for the noise growth, since the noise of BGV must be kept of small magnitude. In this case, the noise added by key switching can become non-negligible in comparison to the multiplication noise, which depends on the plaintext modulus T. This is exactly what happens when the plaintext modulus is small, and this is why we can say that BFV has a small advantage in this case. I'm going to finish this presentation by presenting some experimental results. We've implemented our variants of BFV and BGV in the Palisade C++ library. Some parts of our implementations are already present in the current version of Palisade, and the last optimization will be included in the next release. To the best of our knowledge, this was the first time that BGV and BFV were implemented on the same library, which allows for a fairer comparison of the two schemes. Our experiments were run on a commodity desktop computer operating on Ubuntu with 64 GB of RAM and an Intel CPU running at 3 GHz. Finally, all the experiments were run in a single-threaded mode. Last, I would like to mention that all the experiments were run using hybrid key switching with a 3-digit decomposition. On these graphics, we compare the performance of the homomorphic multiplications of our variants of BFE and BGV at various depths.
First, we notice that our new variant of BGV is faster by a constant factor in comparison of the original BFE, as expected, since we've been able to reduce the size of the second RNS basis, P, by one moduli. Then, we notice that our leveled variant of BFV mimics the behavior of BGV multiplication as expected by becoming more and more efficient as we go deeper into the computation. The most surprising point of this graphics is that we notice that for small and medium plaintext modulus T, BGV seems slower than our leveled variant of BFV. This can be explained by the fact that in our variant of BGV, the size of the moduli depends on T. When T is small, we have small moduli. In BGV, the number of levels corresponds roughly to the number of moduli, while for BFV, the moduli size is independent of the plaintext modulus. Thus, when T is small, we have more moduli in the case of BGV than in the case of BFV, and therefore we need to perform more entity in the first level. And since we are running the experiments on a single-threaded mode, there is a performance difference. Note that this phenomenon is just a particularity of our implementation, and we could make BGV much faster by trunking several BGV small moduli together on the same machine world. For instance, when T equals 2, the moduli are about 20 bits large. Thus, we could theoretically trunk up to 3 moduli on the same 64-bit machine world and compute 3 times less entities. This table compares the performance and noise growth of our variants of BFV and BGV for evaluating a binary tree of depth L using a plaintext modulus T of roughly 16 bits. The column log E corresponds to the size of the noise at the end of the computation. As expected, we notice that our variant of BGV has a noise growth slightly more important than our variant of BFV, while it only has a small performance advantage, but once again, we have to precise that we have not trunked the moduli together in the implementation. Finally, notice that our variant of BGV has a slightly better noise growth than the original BFV, but this is mainly due to the fact that in our variant of BFV, we use the modulus switching right after encryption in order to reduce the encryption noise down to the modulus switching noise. This second table is similar to the first one, but for polynomial evaluation, instead of binary tree evaluation, and the evaluated polynomials are of degree L. This time we notice that our variant of BGV has a significantly higher noise growth than BFV, as expected, since we also have to choose the moduli QY larger to compensate the noise caused by the homomorphic additions. Once again, BGV has a minor advantage in performance in comparison to BFV. To summarize, we've proposed variants of BFV with a somewhat better noise growth than BGV, whereas it was shown previously that the original BFV has the worst noise growth in comparison of BGV when the plaintext modulus T is large. Then, our implementation of BGV can be slightly slower than BFV in the single-threaded mode when the plaintext modulus is small, if the moduli are not trunked together. Overall, we've reduced the complexity of BFV homomorphic multiplication. Our first improvement was to reduce the size of the second RNS basis P by one moduli, which makes us gain a constant number of operations. Our second improvement was to propose a leveled variant of BFV where the multiplication becomes more efficient as the computation progresses, similarly to BGV. Finally, we implemented a variant of BGV which does not require any dynamic noise estimation. This noise is automatically scaled down by one of the moduli before each multiplication, which makes it easier to use and simpler to implement. Unfortunately, this simplicity comes at a cost in performance, since the size of the moduli must be chosen more conservatively than in the dynamic case. This is everything I wanted to present. Thank you for your attention.